You're listening to Kistorian Brothers. Phone calls about Kiss from your friends at Kistorian.com. The originals, keeping it real since 2010.
Hey there, Dave.
Bill, how you doing, brother?
What's happening, my friend?
Not mucho. You made it through rush hour okay.
Rush hour, Chinese food, feeding the cats, and all caught up.
You know, the reason I really wanted to talk to you, besides having met you once and really, you know, just enjoyed your vibe and having seen you online as well and seen bits of your book and seen your videos and seen you in that documentary, is that there's this bit of history that is sort of a mystery.
Well, you know, I grew up here in New Jersey, and my parents were into music. Their records were doo-wop and Duke of Earl and Leader of the Pack and all that kind of stuff. I loved that stuff. And then whatever was on the radio, because so I was tagging along in the car with my mom and my dad, and they'd be playing, you know, whatever's on the radio and 8-tracks and stuff like that. And, you know, my parents didn't play any instruments. I didn't really have any relatives that did. It wasn't until our next door neighbor, we moved to this little town, and this guy next door, black guy, had, you know, this little house, and his front porch was so cool. He had black light posters on the ceiling and on the walls, and these Indian curtains hanging up, and he burned incense, and I would hear him sitting playing his bass. And you know, being curious, Glenn's playing his bass. And one time he caught me peeking in the window, and he's like, "You don't have to peek in the window, come on in," you know. I was like, "Oh, this is so cool," you know. And it's like, geez, I'd love to learn how to play. And so I give him a lot of credit. He kind of taught me, you know, to how to fumble around. And the first song I could get my way through was the Eagles' Victim of Love. You know, just love music. And I mean, grew up at a great time when there was a lot of good music on TV. There'd be variety shows with different bands. And, you know, geez, I even remember, at least I think, when the Elvis Aloha was on TV. Or I know I watched the Johnny Cash show. You know, I mean, you think about it, there was a lot of great variety back then. Not compared to today, there's really... I mean, it's out there, but the kids just aren't exposed to it like I was, or you probably were too. But, you know, it just piqued my interest in music. And my parents, you know, they didn't have a lot of money and stuff, so we went to flea markets. We got a lot of, you know, stuff for our house or whatever at flea markets. And I kind of learned about collecting a little bit, you know. And as a kid, I had a fascination with monster models and wacky package stickers and, you know, posters and cool stuff. And I guess that's what got me into collecting. So those were like my early inspirations towards, I guess, where it brought me now, you know.
And you kind of put Kiss in that same bracket as sort of like bridging both those worlds, right? In not just the collectible world, but, you know, monsters, movies, cartoons.
It's just sort of that. Because it was something, you know, I guess in one way, and I'm sure that Kiss didn't plan it this way, was that they'd appeal towards kids. You know, I doubt that when they sat down and thought about what they were going to do, they'd go like, "Oh yeah, the kids will love this."
I think at first it was more like, "Hey, we're going to be cutting edge, gnarly, fucking heavy, and kick your teeth in."
Yeah, black leather and silver.
Yeah, and then once
blood and, you
once
know.
They got a bird's eye view of the Emerald City from Bill, right?
I guess, you know, it's funny the way things just kind of worked out in life.
You're listening to Kistorian Brothers. Phone calls about Kiss from your friends at Kistorian.com. The originals, keeping it real since 2010.
luckily, my parents had some pretty interesting friends, and a lot of them were into music, and I know that they went to concerts.
Did you have an older brother or sister, Bill?
No, I was an only child, so I didn't have that influence with the older brother with records or something. You know, it was really friends or my parents. And
Gene was an only child.
Well, you know, I think it makes you a little different because you just create your own little world and you figure, well, I got nobody else here, so I might as well make it interesting.
Absolutely.
Well, so maybe that's what led, like, as a kid, I was into magic. I was into drawing. I was into, as a matter of fact, I loved pinball machines, and I tried to make my own little pinball game. I did two different ones, and I only have a picture of one of them, which I called the Mr. Bill pinball machine because Mr. Bill was so big at the time. Off the top of my head, I remember buying, the Carpenters, and I remember buying, Cheech and Chong, the one that was class, stuff like that. But as far as the first album that I bought,
and then we'll go to Love Gun.
I'm on a blank on it.
Oh, that's cool. So take me to your Love Gun story.
Like I said, I was into, lots of, 45s and whatever the hit of the day was. So, obviously it was probably the summer of 77. Like the next town over from where I live, my aunt lived there and she was the school nurse, and she would go away for the summers because she wasn't teaching in school, and she had a grandson, and I guess for some reason she stayed home because we used to go and stay in her house when she wasn't there. And my cousin was there, my aunt was there, my mom brought me up, and we're all together, and we convinced them to take us to the record store because, well, we want to score a record of some sort, whatever we could get. I wanted a Kiss record because I had already heard Alive, and my other friend had Destroyer, and it was just, I still remember my best friend Mike at the time calls me up and he invites me over, and he had just bought the 45 for Dr. Love and Take Me. And, we're sitting there listening to this like, oh my God, I don't know how many times we played it, but we were just like, this is just unlike anything else we had ever heard.
Yeah.
And so my other friend had Alive, which was, beyond words, and the pictures and the book and the little notes that they wrote. And then my other friend had Destroyer. So I'm like, well, I got to get a record. So we managed to get to the record store, and I find there's two copies of Love Gun. There's one sealed and one open. Now, as a kid, I didn't know what a promotional copy was. But since this record was open, it was a dollar less. So my mother's like, well, you're going to get that one. Well, it turns out it was a promo.
Nice.
I guess they sent it to the store, and they decided to sell it. Well, my cousin got Fleetwood Mac Rumors. And when we got back to the house, of course, I want to play my side first. He wants to play his side first. So we had to flip a coin, and whoever won played one side first, and the other person got to play a side. So for the first time ever, I heard Love Gun and Fleetwood Mac Rumors, which to this day still remains in my head. But of course, my cousin's like, oh, do you want to trade? I'm like, no.
That's hilarious.
And I mean, I remember, I can still picture it, hearing Shock Me for the first time, because I thought Ace was cool, and one of the kids in my class said, that's a girl. I'm like, it's not a girl, And, that track on it, the whole album has a certain tone to it, but that track is a little different, and Ace's voice just, it stands out, and his lead playing stands out.
Yeah.
So, it was just inspirational. From there, of course, luckily in that little town I lived in, there was a couple little record stores. And the guy had a deal. I think if you bought 10, you got your 11th free. So, of course, I started buying records like crazy, mowing lawns and doing whatever I could with money. And, you know, and then buying the Kiss magazines and, you know, the Kiss cards. And then, of course, you know, I remember my father waking me up when Kiss was on, what was that, Midnight Special.
Wow. 1974,
is that 75? Yeah, yep. And, you know, who knows what time it was in the morning. He woke me up, he goes, that band Kiss is on TV. And I was, you know, half awake, but like jolted awake because, oh my God, there they are live. And, oh, gee, you know. And, you know, now we look back and I forget, didn't they have Black Diamond and Peter threw his drums off the riser because he was pissed off about something?
Well, not on the show, not on that actual show, but he, you know, it should be noted that if he sucked at singing, why was he the one closing every show?
Yeah, exactly.
But continue, my friend, this is most fascinating.
But you know, at least Kiss was on TV a little bit, and then, you know, they were in magazines, and then the comic book came out, and the Grooves magazines, man, they were my favorite. They were just, there were so many great pictures, and, you know, and I have some good pictures of my old bedroom, and I had a lot of good Kiss posters, and, you know, you cut out the pinups and hang them up. So, I mean, I was definitely the geeky, you know, Kiss fan growing up, and a lot of kids in my school, they didn't like Kiss. I would almost say I was pretty much alone, like in Kiss, with the exception of one other, my friend Mike. It was weird. Everybody was into, you know, Sabbath or Zeppelin or later on AC/DC, Judas Priest. But, you know, Kiss was unique. I mean, a lot of people you hear say they got into fights or got beat up or whatever for liking Kiss. So
I broke a guy's nose, but I don't want to talk about it. So let me ask you this.
Okay,
did you see Kiss with makeup before the reunited?
I didn't see Kiss until the reunion, and you know what, maybe I could have, I don't remember, but I do remember that my parents did take me to see Doug Henning in the Magic Show, which for me was amazing because I loved Magic. So I don't remember if the Kiss opportunity came up. So I never got to see them until the reunion, which of course I had to buy a ticket for.
So take me into high school. Are you playing guitar in bands? Where are you at musically? What's going on?
You know, when I first picked up the guitar, well, you know, I started on bass, and the guy Glenn that lived next door, sadly, I don't know, he got into some kind of trouble and, like, had to move out in the middle of the night and left me an acoustic guitar by our back door.
That's your first guitar?
That's my first guitar.
Dude, that is so weird.
You're listening to Kistorian Brothers. Phone calls about Kiss from your friends at Kistorian.com. The originals, keeping it real since 2010.
And my friend had just started playing guitar, so he was kind of trying to teach me on the acoustic, and we were trying to, like, write our own little songs and stuff like that, and, you know, I guess just like any other guy that picks up the guitar, it's like, well, I'm going to pick up the guitar because it'll impress the girls, you know?
Yeah.
And, you know, just kind of stuck with it. I took some lessons here and there, and I, you know, try to upgrade my guitar and, you know, buy whatever I could. I found guitars in the garbage, and I started playing around with them and working on them. And I had this little desk, and I made my own little bench where I would take the guitars apart and do whatever, clean them, or think I was fixing them or soldering them. Or I had this one Tysco Del Rey or Tysco guitar, and the pickups were just screwed to the face, and I decided, well, if I move them around, they'll, you know, sound different. And so I was experimenting with stuff like that, and So, yeah, my friend Mike and I, we kind of created this little band that we called it Destroy, and we took Christmas lights and put doorbells on them so that when we stepped on it, the lights would turn on, and we stood on these crates with Christmas lights on there, and that was our stage, and, you know, we were dreaming about being big rock stars. And then as I got older, you know, I'd find a friend, and I want to play something. Like, here, you'll play bass, I'll play guitar, and we'll find a drummer, and started jamming on stuff. And I was really inspired by Hendrix first, I think, because I'd kind of gotten out of the Kiss stuff, and my same friend Mike came over with this Hendrix album, and I was like, whoa, what's this, you know? Saying that, you know, this guy's really doing something with the guitar. So I think that's what really pushed me to want to play guitar.
Yeah, but he would have been dead by then, right? I mean...
Oh, yeah. No, Hendrix was, you know...
Yeah, okay. I'm just checking my timeline here, Bill.
Yeah. So, you know, so then, you know, like junior high, I found another kid, and I was teaching him bass, and I think his dad was a guitar player, so... They got him a bass, and we had this friend that played drums, and we had a weird combination of Hendrix stuff and maybe a little Chuck Berry, Born to Be Wild, but we also mixed in like the Sex Pistols.
So it was like a power trio, punky power, New Jersey punky power trio.
It's funny, we played in an apartment complex one time for my friend's going away. He was going into the army, and. Played away, and I think the cops even came, and
that's success.
That was a wild thing, and I took a guitar and poured lighter fluid on it and lit it and smashed it, and everyone in school thought I was just like, you know, cool and crazy at the same time. And
you know, good for you. You know, they can never take those moments away.
And it's funny, you know, when I was working with Ace, the only thing I really had for him was that he just was so lackadaisical about his gear, and it, you know, was falling apart and blowing up, and it was really just, you got to pay attention to your stuff. If you want to be a musician and be professional, either you better have somebody working for you that is doing everything for you, or you better be on the ball yourself.
Do you think it was just not... I know he grew up tinkering with guitars too, but do you think that he just got spoiled and used to people taking care of it and is sort of brain dead enough that he didn't care?
Because you're back in the Kiss days, you know, of course they had roadies.
Sure.
He had a guitar tech. I think the guy's name was Tex at the time, but, you know, guitar techs back then were a lot different than they are today, but... You know, and Ace did say that he tinkered with stuff, but to what degree, like, believe me, I've seen his solder attempts, and he, you know.
Okay.
If he got better, then he's still just picking up the soldering iron, but.
So tell us how you met Ace, Bill.
All right, well, so I was involved in the Kiss conventions kind of in a small way because I was really good friends with Richie Ranna. I still am, but. Back then we hung out a lot, and we even did record shows together and stuff. So I think I'd missed the first couple Kiss conventions, but then he would give me a table and I'd hang out. And I was kind of getting back into Kiss, and I you know, had other stuff to sell, whatever. It was just fun to be there. You know, who doesn't love a good, you know, convention with stuff to buy and look at? So, I was at this table right next to, there was a guy in the city. Remember the place, It's Only Rock and Roll, that was on 8th Street? It was upstairs. They had amazing stuff. And that guy even had one of Ace's smokers and some cool stuff because he was friends with Richie and got stuff out of the museum. Anyway, he was next to me. And middle of the day, toward the end of the day, this guy comes walking around and he's got this guitar case. And I guess someone directed him to the guy, Mark, who was next to me, It's Only Rock and Roll guy, I guess to show it to him because he was trying to sell a guitar. So he lays the case on the table, he opens it up, and it's this guitar, and I'd never seen a guitar like that. if I had, you know,
a guitar like
I
what?
I didn't remember it, but it was like, cause they were, it was unusual. And he's telling the guy, this is Ace Frehley's guitar, and he picks up these couple of Polaroids. And he's like, here's Ace with the guitar, here's Ace signing the guitar. And I'm like, oh, I'm looking at this, like, wow, you know. He looks at me, he goes, are you interested in buying this? I'm like, I don't have any money, you know. I said, it's really cool, though. I've never seen that. I repair guitars for a living. He's like, really? Well, you know, he's like, I collect guitars, and I guess we just started talking, and he let me look at the guitar. And he says, yeah, I collect all kinds of guitars, and I have old Marshalls and Fenders and blah, blah, blah. And I said, yeah, I kind of, you know, I have some cool old Marshall stuff, and I got a, you know, this and that. And he's like, well, you know, what kind of stuff do you have? You know, I got a Marshall head and cabinet, you know. So he's telling me about all the stuff that he has, and he says, yeah, I'm getting this really rare tall 412 cabinet. And they were really rare. They're very unusual. It's like a 412, but it's taller. And I said, really? I said, who are you getting that from? And he mentions this guy, Don. And I'm like, really? Because, of course, he says his last name. And I'm like, well, I also know Don, and Don is trying to buy my tall 412 Marshall cabinet. And he looks at me like, I'll give you this guitar for that cabinet right now. And I'm like, okay. He's like, really, I want it. You could take it home. You could bring it to me tomorrow. He's like, as a matter of fact, I'll have Ace come over.
Hey, Bill.
Yeah.
Can I interject? So at this point, do you know about the Washburn guitar deal? What is this, a prototype? What are you thinking?
Well, it was Ace's guitar. It was the one in the video for Into the Night. Matter of fact, if you ever watched the video Into the Night, there was a piece of tape across the case. And the piece of tape was still on the case, and if you look real close, in Ace's handwriting, it said, fragile, handle with care. This phone number, I gave him my phone number, and of course, there was a couple other people there that vouched for me, that said, that, you know, who I was, and he trusted me to take the guitar home, and so the next day, I loaded
wow.
up the speaker cabinet. I grabbed a few things to get signed and drove up to Al lived up in Dobbs Ferry, New York, still does. And Ace comes over strolling in, and you know, to me, I'm like, oh my God, you know, Ace Frehley from Kiss. You know, comes over and he doesn't know who I am, and Al introduces me and says, oh, you know, he got your Washburn guitar. And he's like, oh, you know. And I guess Al told him, oh, you know, he traded me for this cabinet. And Ace was kind of like, well, whatever. He really was just coming over for the money. And
yeah.
Ace is like, oh, I'm hungry. Let's go eat. And Al's like, yeah, let's go to, they named some place. And I'm like, what's that? And they're like, oh, it's sushi. And I had never had sushi in my life. So I'm like, okay. You know? So as a matter of fact, I even think that Al drove, and I think I sat in the front and he sat in the back. We're just kind of making small talk on the way over, and we get there, and we're, you know, just hanging out.
Were you freaking out at all? Were you just like, yeah, I'm this cool, and this makes sense?
Oh, it was just kind of, it was surreal, because at this, you know, Ace was very, what do you say, just full of personality. He was just like laughing. He had a smile on his face. You know, he could have been partying or, you know, what, he could have just been having a great day, but he was, he just had this charm to him, and him and Al had a really good rapport, and I felt very comfortable.
Great.
But at the same time, I'm saying into my head that this is the guy that was on the posters, that, you know, this is the guy that, you know, did shock me, and it just, you know, and we were making small talk, and one thing led to another, and we started talking about Jimi Hendrix. And Ace, like, lit up. He's like, "Hi, Rudy for Jimi Hendrix." Or I have to say, like, here, you know, "Hi, Rudy for Jimi Hendrix." And I was like, "Really?" And he's like, "Yeah, at Randall's Island." He says, "You know, I helped Mitch set up the drums, and I was on the stage." And he's like, "You should have seen me. I was a skinny kid with these bell-bottom jeans and a shirt with a star on it, and my hair was all long." And, you know, I was like, "Oh, wow, it's amazing." And I said, "Well, I happen to have the audio of that show on a soundboard on cassette, and I know I have two or three songs on video from that show." And he was like, "Oh my God, really? You got to make me a copy of that." And I was like, "Yeah, sure." Or, you know, so he grabs a napkin and he gets a pen. He's like, "Here, you got to give me your phone number." Okay, so I give him the phone number, you know. He sticks it in his pocket. And so we finish up the night, and then he's got to go. And, you know, I guess I probably hung out with Al a little bit. Oh, and then before he's left, he signed a few things for me, and I even had him sign a guitar strap. I had him write, "Take care of my guitar." He would sell me something and say, "Well, I want $500 for it," and then turn around and just give me the earring off the cover of the first album for free as a gift. At times he could really surprise you and be smart, and at times he, I can still never forget him calling me one time, "Why was I supposed to call you?" I was like, "I have your guitar." "Oh yeah." But no, he, and you know, I'll tell you, after, let me continue where I was.
Yeah, brother.
When I told you about the Hendrix thing, so this is going to take us into the Ace realm. Go home. I'm on cloud nine. I look at my guitar strap, and I brought a Grooves, and I think I brought a record along, and just got those three items signed.
Nice.
And, so the next morning, I'm up and I'm getting ready for work, and the phone rings, and I pick up the phone. "Bill, did you make my tapes yet?"
Huh.
I'm like, "Ace?" And so, yeah, first thing the next morning, he could not forget about those tapes. So I said, "No, I didn't make them. I'm going to work." "When can you make them?" "I need you to make those tapes. I got to hear those tapes." "Okay, I'll make them tonight. When do you want them?" "Can you come up this way tomorrow night?" I was like, "Well, yeah, I got to get home. I got to make them." You know, so I guess I went back up and we met at Al's house again.
Do you think that he got pleasure, not in a negative way, about being able to make people feel special?
I would think so, in the same way that I'm sure, like, Elvis did. Yeah, anybody that's mega famous.
Right, you've read a lot about Elvis doing that, too.
Oh, yeah, a lot about Elvis. Love Elvis. But they know the influence or the spell that they put on people. And, you know, I felt that I wasn't nervous. I was kind of very relaxed with him the first time I met him, and we, you know, talking. And then when we were talking about Hendrix, and, you know, I told him how, you know, I was so into Hendrix and I had this collection, and I was kind of in the process of selling things because, I mean, I don't know if you collect a lot of things, but people that you deal with in the different collectors world,
right.
When I was big into Hendrix I dealt with a lot of really crappy people, and it just turned me so sour to it.
Yeah.
And I just kind of wanted to get rid of a lot of the stuff. I got so burned out on it, and I told Ace, you know, I'm selling some stuff, and, you know, I said I went to the Kiss convention, and I bought a few cool Kiss things, and I'm, you know, going to get back into Kiss. And maybe a little light went on in his head, maybe I could sell him a few things, you know. And it did come up, so the next time that I saw him, I even said to him, because I made him some extra Hendrix stuff. I just figured, well, if this guy liked Hendrix, I'll bring him some cool stuff. And I said, hey, if you ever have any memorabilia or anything you want to part with, let me know.
Yeah.
And sure enough, you know, one day my phone rings, and it was him, and I do remember him saying something like, you know, I was thinking maybe I could get some more Hendrix from you, and, you know, I found, you know, such and such, and thought, you know, if you'd be interested, I'd like to get, you know, and I forget whatever figure it was, $1,000 or $2,000, you know, can you come up with that? Yeah, sure, you know. That's why I ran to the bank with my credit card to take cash advances. I didn't have the money, you know. But I wasn't going to turn him down. I got the money, and
that's hot shit, man.
Went up, and we used to meet before. He said to me, he goes, you know, I don't know you that well, so I can't have you to my house. I'm like, oh, that's fine. So we used to meet in a Staples parking lot up in White Plains.
You're listening to Kistorian Brothers. Phone calls about Kiss from your friends at Kistorian.com. The originals, keeping it real since 2010.